Hello everyone, welcome to Sunday Catchup from St James and St Anne's, Bermondsey. Today's reading is Luke 12, verses 13 to 21. This Sunday was our Harvest Thanksgiving service, and we were pleased to welcome as our guest preacher Odell, our placement student from All Nations Christian College in Hertfordshire. Odell comes from Rwanda, and he's training for the ministry of God's church in Rwanda. In a few moments, we will hear his message to us for Harvest about the parable of the rich fool. But first, we have our first song.
And scatter the good seed on the land, but it is fed and watered by God's almighty hand. He sends the snow in winter, the warmth to swell the grain, the breezes and the sunshine and soft refreshing rain. All good gifts around are sent from heaven above. Then thank the Lord, oh thank the Lord for all his love. He only is the maker of all things near and far. He paints the wayside flower, he lights the evening star. And waves obey him, by him the birds are fed. Much more to us his children he gives our daily bread. All good gifts around us are sent from heaven above. Then thank the Lord, oh thank the Lord for all his love. Father, for all things bright and good, the seed time and the harvest, our life, our health, our food. Accept the gifts we offer, for all thy love imparts, and what thou most desirest, our humble, thankful hearts. All good gifts around are sent from heaven above, then thank the Lord, oh thank the Lord for all his love. All good gifts around us are sent from heaven above, then thank the Lord, oh thank the Lord for all his love.
To be able to understand the And when you start from verse 1, you get to know that Jesus was speaking to a crowd of many thousands, warning them of Pharisaic hypocrisy, telling them not to fear those who kill the body, but those who can cast them into hell, encouraging them to confess him before people, and telling them that they will face opposition, and assuring them that the Holy Spirit will give them the right words when they are dragged before the authorities. So suddenly, in the middle of his sermon to these thousands of people, a man interrupts him, asking him to settle inheritance disputes between his brother. Unfortunately, his request gives his intentions away. It looks like he wasn't listening to what Jesus was talking about all along. Can you imagine if you are teaching math and one of your students interrupts and asks you a totally irrelevant history question? The same applies to this man who interrupted Jesus, because it looks like, first of all, he asked a question that is totally out of context, not related to what Jesus was speaking about. Secondly, according to Jesus' response on verse 14, it shows that this man misunderstood who Jesus was. He did not understand the difference between Jesus and other rabbis. In the Gospel times, and I think even today, a rabbi was a teacher and interpreter of the Torah. Torah was the Jewish law. On top of those roles, a rabbi was also a qualified person to settle and handle civil cases, such as property and monetary disputes. Although Jesus was often called a rabbi, he had a different mission, and handling property and monetary disputes was not at the core of that mission. This is why he rejects being a judge of a case which could be easily settled by any other rabbi. Regarding the inheritances, Jewish laws were very clear. According to Deuteronomy 21, if there were two sons, the firstborn was entitled to get two-thirds of their father's inheritance. The second son was entitled to, if there were two sons, the firstborn was entitled to get two-thirds of their father's inheritance. If the secondborn was entitled to get a third of the inheritance. If there are three sons, the firstborn was to receive 50% of the inheritance, and the others were to receive 25% each. If there were four sons, the firstborn was entitled to get 40%, and the rest were to share 20% each. So it was very clear, and it would have been settled by any other rabbi. It was written down in the Jewish laws. It was even clear, the Torah was even clear. It specified the line of inheritance and prohibited transfers of inheritance between tribes. So, why was this man interrupting Jesus in the middle of his sermon? Well, you can't hide anything from Jesus, can you? When this man interrupted Jesus, Jesus saw through and saw his interior motive. When this man interrupted asking Jesus to instruct his brother to share inheritance with him, Jesus does not see a man who seeks justice. Jesus sees a man who is full of greed. That's why in verse 14, Jesus tells him and everyone present to watch out, be on their guards against all kinds of greed, for life is not all about material possession. There is more to life than material possessions. Jesus was a very great teacher. He therefore uses a parable of the rich fool to further elaborate what he meant by the word life does not consist in an abundance of possessions. To be honest, do you wonder why this farmer is called a fool? When our sister was reading, did you pay attention? Why is this farmer called a rich fool? His farming business is thriving. He is planning to expand his barns and build bigger ones, for the ones he had are smaller, for his harvest has increased. He has not robbed anyone. He has not committed any crime to gain his possessions. So why is Jesus calling him a rich fool? What are we missing here? When looking at this parable, you barely notice anything wrong with this guy Jesus calls a rich fool. But when you look carefully, you notice what Jesus was talking about. So let's carefully analyze this parable and see what we're missing and what Jesus was trying to talk to us in this parable. When you read on verse 16, it reads, "The ground of a certain rich man yielded an abundant harvest." Well, this statement on verse 16 shows that this man was rich even before the harvest. The ground of a certain rich man yielded. This statement itself shows that this man was rich even the harvest. The harvest simply increases his fortune. It is also definitely a blessing from God. Moreover, the harvest was even much more than this man had initially anticipated. When you go further on verse 17, the first part of it, he thought to himself. It reads, he thought to himself. This is the man Jesus calls the rich fool. He thought to himself. That statement shows that he talks with nobody but himself. He is self-centered and requires no counsel. He does not even look to God for guidance. The second part of verse 17 reads, "What shall I do? I have no place to store my crops." Many people would like to be in this position, having more money than we know what to do with. However, I think that's another type of poverty. I'm not sure if I am the only one saying that money is all that this man has. He seems to have no family, no friends, no sense of community at all. Isn't that poverty? He is rich in money, but poor in everything else. On verse 18 and 19, it reads, "Then he said, this is what I will do. I will tear down my barns and build bigger ones, and there I will store my surplus grain, and I will say to myself, you have plenty of grain laid up for many years. Take life easy, eat, drink, and be merry." The harvest has exceeded his expectations. As I said earlier, the Bible does not show anything wrong with acquisition of his harvest. No crime committed at all. However, look at the self-centeredness in this parable. It is interesting to see the number of times this man uses self-centered prefixes, I and mine. In my Bible, I was trying to highlight the times he uses I and mine. And it is surprising to see how many times he uses those self-centered prefixes in such a short conversation with himself alone. I found he uses six times, I six times, and my five times. That shows you how self-absorbed this man was. On verse 20, verse 21, it says, "But God said to him, 'You fool, this very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you have prepared for yourself? This is how it will be with whoever stores up things for themselves, but is not rich toward God.'" Self-absorption does not allow him to think or acknowledge the owner of life, the one who gives it and the one who takes it whenever he wants. This man deceives himself that since he's very rich, he could eat, drink, and live for many years. He tells himself that he has plenty of grain laid up for many years, but God takes life from him that very night. The possessions he had blinded him to acknowledge God. How foolish he was not to realize that there is more to life than material possessions. How foolish he was not to realize that his possessions were a blessing from God and should be thankful to him. How foolish he was not to realize that he had received plenty, but there are others in the community who are not as fortunate as he was. In Deuteronomy chapter 15, verse 11, it says, "There will always be poor people in the land. Therefore, I command you to be open-handed to the poor and needy in your land." This is God commanding Israelites when they are going to the promised land. As I conclude, there are a few takeaway points in this parable. We should learn to be thankful to the Lord for what we have. We should always know that there is more to life than material possessions. And finally, when we are blessed, let us not forget to give a hand to those who bless that what we have. Thank you very much. May God bless you.
Thank you for joining us for Sunday Catchup from St James and St Anne's, Bermondsey. Please join us next week for another Sunday Catchup. And now let's join in with our concluding song.